Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen. This is Run It Back. My name is Remco Rinkema, and today I am joined by the champ. Once again, all the champs are coming on this show. This week, it is Ryan Reese. We are watching the 2013 WSOP main event final table. I'm very sad to say, Ryan, right off the bat here, I don't see a Detroit jersey or a hat or a scarf or anything. You're dressed down for the occasion. First and foremost, what's going on? How are you holding up?
I'm good. Just got the air conditioning fixed, and you know in Vegas how brutal it can be with no AC. So I'm in a very good mood today.
Oh, perfect. I catch you at the right time. That's awesome. All right, you guys who are just tuning in to this show for the very first time on Run It Back, I have a new guest twice a week to watch some epic poker action, and that can be high-stakes poker after dark, or in this case, a WSOP main event final table. Don't forget to like this video, subscribe to the channel, and if you miss the show, just go back into the archives and watch them all. I've had Greg Raymer, Chris Moneymaker, Joe Hashem, Lex Veldhaus. I've had them all on the show already, and today it is time for the 2013 main event final table. Ryan, to set the tone for this episode, I'm going to run the intro to get the juices flowing for this final table. So let's just enjoy the music and the intro and some Chris Moneymaker action, and then I think you and I both will be ready for some breakdowns of these moments.
Sounds good.
All right, let's roll the tape and dive in.
Ago, I won the World Series of Poker main event.
Chris Moneymaker is atop the poker world.
I realized every poker player's dream.
Tonight, 9 players get the chance to do what I did 10 years ago. Win the main event.
The great part about having the chip lead is I'm able to go in there and have a variety of styles to play. I have more room for trial and error.
So I'm the short stack. What's going to happen most likely is that within the first orbit or two, I'm going to be getting all in. Now, if I double up, I can start putting some chips together. I think I have as good a chance as anybody.
I'm happy to be the underdog and have people feel like I am the amateur. I personally have confidence in my own abilities.
Millions are at stake with this bracelet for the champion.
The World Series of Poker main event final table. Someone else's dream gets dealt tonight.
Just brings back great memories. I was so young then, and it's cool to be back in those shoes. I was very naive at the time, but it's kind of cool. I liked it.
Yeah, so today we're going to break down this final table. When's the last time you've seen it, and how many times have you seen it?
I've honestly not seen it that many times. I don't really like rewatching my final tables for whatever reason. I watched it all on TV, like when it was airing and stuff, but I don't know how many times I've actually sat down and watched it from start to finish. It's pretty long, but I haven't relived a lot of the hands in years, so this will be a lot of fun.
Awesome. I can't wait to break some of them down. Obviously, the further we get into this final table, the more you'll get involved, because obviously shorthanded play and all that good stuff, and we have quite a few eliminations to go through before we get to this point. So let's start this conversation with how you ended up in the main event in the first place. What was your road to playing in the world's biggest tournament?
It's kind of a cool road for me. So the end in 2012, I was going to Michigan State. I was a student. And my last semester of college, I actually drove to Indiana to play a poker tournament, the WSOP circuit in Hammond. And I chopped it 3 ways for like $280,000. And before that, I had no money. I think I had $2,000 to my name, or like I used every dollar to my name to buy into that tournament. And I had all my own action. And so that was kind of crazy. Went from being like broke, like basically broke my whole life, to having a lot of money all at once. And I was in college getting ready to graduate. And then after I graduated, I started playing poker full time. And this was the first WSOP and main event that I played.
Wow, incredible. When you go to visit Orion's Hendon Mob, you know, this story checks out, because your first ever cash, October 2012, $239,000. Did you go from like being the stereotypical broke student to all of a sudden living the high life? Or did you have, you know, any smart decisions in your repertoire?
Well, I won that tournament 2 months before I graduated, like 6 weeks before I graduated. So I didn't have too much time to really live it up. But I bought a car. and paid off all my student loans. So it was actually perfect timing. It couldn't have been more perfect for me.
That's incredible. We are watching the first big all-in from this final table. It is Mark Etienne McLaughlin with Pocket Kings against the Queens of Mark Newhouse, who has a big cheering section with Tio Tran, Mike Matisau, Chino Ream. Obviously, you know, we all know the Mark Newhouse fate in back-to-back years, so we'll get to that. But it's cool to see these hands play out in the background and noticing that Newhouse actually got a hold of quite a few chips there right off the bat. When you go from broke to all of a sudden having a bunch of money and clearly, you know, quite a few layers of confidence after one big score, because that's how poker players work. You know, you have a big score, you get a lot of confidence. How did you then go from that to being like, okay, I'm going to play WSOP events, I'm going to play the main event?
Well, I've always wanted to play poker. It was always my dream. So after I made a lot of money and then graduated from college, it felt like perfect timing for me to just try to play poker. If it doesn't work out, I have my degree in my back pocket. I could always get a normal 9-to-5 job if it didn't work out for me. But for me, poker was always the dream. And like you said, after I won a lot of money, it made the dreams a lot more attainable, because poker is such a hard thing to get into, like, for a full-time profession. I honestly wouldn't recommend it to anyone. I don't know if you want me to say that on the air, but yeah, it's just so hard to make it. But I was very, very lucky.
So obviously, in the beginning, when things go well, you think, you know, this is the easiest game in the world. I'm just going to print money forever. Did it take a very long time for you to get that realization, or was it something that you learned pretty quickly because of the ups and downs of the game?
I mean, yeah, at the time, I thought I was the best. I thought I was going to win the main event every 4 years or something, you know, because it was the first time I played. I won. I've had a ton of success, really, in my first year of playing poker. So it's easy when it comes very easy at first. It's easy to kind of think that, oh, this is going to happen forever. And then you realize, like, man, it's so hard to even make, like, to even cash the main event since then. So it's very humbling, to say the least.
Yeah, no, that totally makes sense. This main event, though, your first ever, was it a smooth sailing route to the final table, or, you know, were you ever in any big trouble?
To start day 7, I believe, I was last in chips with 27 left or so. I had 10 big blinds.
Wow.
I was at the very, very bottom of the chip counts. But up until, like, throughout days 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5, I was smooth sailing the whole time. I was actually all in on the bubble, like 5 from the money, and doubled up with an overpair against a straight draw. So that was nerve-wracking, because if I lose that, my everything changes, obviously. So, but it was pretty smooth until day 7. Day 6 and 7, I was pretty short and had a few double ups, and the cards went my way.
So day 7 was really the big day for you, because obviously you started this final table with a ton of chips, sort of taking the pressure off, you know, not having to do much in the first couple of hours of this final table. Talk to me about, you know, any hand you might remember from day 7 that was crucial in your sort of rise towards the top. And then secondly, talk about your preparation for the final table.
I had a few double ups early in the day through my friend Chris Lind. I don't know if you remember, but he was the chip leader, or one of them, on day 7. He had all the chips. He was playing a lot of hands. I won king, queen against nines against him in a spot where I wouldn't shove nowadays, which is funny. But back then I shoved and it worked. And then I had ace, queen against ace 10 against him also, when he three bet McLaughlin, actually, ahead of me. So he was priced in to call. And that kind of gave me some breathing room. And then I won a big pot against Rhett Porter with 11 left, nines against King Jack. And if I lose that, I have 8 big blinds or something with 11 left. So, I won a lot of flips when it counted.
Wow, that's awesome. And then your preparation for the final table. Over the years, I've heard from people, they do simulations, they study. Some people take vacations, some people just grind. What was your approach in that sort of 3-month period?
This is another thing that I would change if I could go back in time. But I played poker. I like played in Atlantic City. I went to Paris for WSOP Europe. But I didn't do any sims or studying, really. I was really confident in my own game at the time. And I didn't want to take on coaching from players that were way better than me and then kind of not be able be like lost in hands, kind of, you know what I mean? Trying to play like, oh, what would so-and-so do, rather than just play my own game. I think you could see who did Kui Nguyen beat heads up?
Gordon Veo.
Gordon Veo, yeah. He's a great player. And I know he had really good coaches. I think he had Tom Marchese and Schindler coached them. I could be wrong on this, but I'm pretty sure that's correct. And I know at the final table, like when he was heads up, he seemed kind of lost in some hands, where if he maybe didn't take on any coaching and just played one-on-one against Kui, he may have won. But he was trying to play to GTO. And at the time, I wasn't very good in that sense, and I didn't want to make life harder on myself. So I didn't take on any coaching, really. I had friends that helped me at the final table, like Lonnie Harwood, Phil, Huey, and they are great poker players, and they helped me so much. I wouldn't have been able to do what I did at the final table without them. But in the months leading up to the final table, I really didn't do much preparation.
So then when you're at this final table and, you know, it is just over 700K for ninth and it's more than $8 million for first. So incredible pay jumps, lots of pressure. You're on the big stage, Penn & Teller Theater. There's a lot of sort of chaos happening around you. How do you stay calm if you did? And how do you sort of handle yourself in the moment? Like, describe that to me.
I don't know how I did it, to be honest, but I felt like I did a really good job at blocking everything out. Like I had 150 people there or something on my rail. It was crazy. Like back when it was in Penn and Teller Theater, it was incredible. I wish we could go back to those times. But yeah, I had a lot of people, and I heard like things that were said on the rail, and I honestly didn't even hear them, and they were 10 feet from me screaming it. So I was really locked in and focused, and I tried to block everything else out and just do my best.
How much were you worried or concerned or maybe even just aware of the pay jumps and how ninth place would be, you know, maybe a nice house, but first place would be life-changing money that would forever alter the course of, you know, the next couple decades?
Yeah, at the time, like I said, I was really naive. I didn't understand how big of a spot it was, and I didn't want to almost overthink things. Like looking back, like if I was in this spot again, oh, my first big.
Here we go. First that I won. First big hand. Let's turn it up and listen.
Newhouse's main event.
And now the flop and a king for Ryan Reese. Newhouse now looking at being the first.
Yeah, you look more nervous even though you're just waiting for the cards.
Last board of this 2013 main event.
Turn card another seven. Reese, a 19-1 favorite now. Mark Newhouse, a card away from ninth place.
My hair was so long.
Newhouse has got to have a nine on the river.
The river card, the six of diamonds. And Mark Newhouse, who had a wild day seven ride from chip leader to feeling lucky to make this final table.
Lots of tall people at this final table. Let the record show that.
Yeah, we did. Amir is tall and Mark.
And Mihil is also very tall. It's kind of funny to
Problem
see
house, that. Yeah, we did have some tall people. It might be the tallest final table.
Yeah, this is a stat, you guys. If you're watching this in the comments, let us know if this was the tallest final table of all time. Mark Newhouse departs in ninth place, and we all know what happened the following year, which actually you guys can see in the episode with Martin Jacobson, in which we discussed the very same thing. So this first big moment for you, winning that big flip, was that sort of, you know, sigh of relief, you know, we got the pay jump and also, you know, more chips and sort of a comfort level increase?
Yeah, for sure. Just a huge weight off your shoulders knowing that, like, say I lose that flip, now I'm one of the shortest stacks with nine left and I'm at risk of getting ninth or eighth or something. So this, that was, I'm sure that calmed my nerves a lot, just knowing that I have a little bit more breathing room to negotiate or to navigate my way around.
Here we got a raise from JC Tran, the start of the final table chip leader. David Benefield, the start of the day short stack, all in with King Deuce suited and Jay Farber waking up with Ace King behind him. So let's listen in.
Pushed around by the big stack, but he's about to be blindsided by the amateur.
Call.
Farber makes the call with ace king.
Benefield knows that's bad news. Farber's been pretty tight.
Tran quickly folds. You see Benefield shaking his head at his crew, saying, "I'm in bad shape."
Well, I thought Benefield might have been a little more patient, but I certainly can see him pushing in that spot.
So Farber, the solid amateur, picks up a big hand and has Benefield dominated. 5-10 queen, no immediate help for Benefield. Farber with the Broadway draw.
Jack of, will you take the jack of spades?
I think I'm gonna need a little help here.
Will you take the jack of spades?
Oh yeah.
All right.
Well, I take the jack of spades, yes.
David's girlfriend looks more worried than he. Turn card now. You want the jack of spades, you got it.
Wow, I don't remember that.
The VIP host knows how to take care of people, as promised.
They called it.
Benefield, jack of spades.
Wow.
Flush draw for Benefield.
For Benefield, any spade wins the whole pot. A red ace, and they'll chop the pot. Otherwise, he is gone.
The river card, the deuce of diamonds. David Benefield comes up short, but did manage to...
Arguably the toughest and most experienced player at the final table, along with perhaps JC Tran, eliminated there. You know, can't really feel too bad about that in your position. But coming into the final table, how did you rank yourself versus the opposition? And as far as, you know, the stack sizes, were you worried about anyone in particular?
I really did not want David to accumulate chips, Benefield. I actually made a really tight fold to him with, I thought it was with 9 left, but it may have been with 10 left. I think it was with 10 left, actually, now that I think about it. But it was at the final table. And I opened ace-queen under the gun, and he shoved 10 big blinds a couple of seats over, and I folded. And he had ace-king. But, I really didn't want him to get chips because, like you could see with the king-deuce shove, he was fearless in a sense. And just very, very smart, successful person. And it's kind of funny. Me and him were the only people at the final table to not have any patches, not wear any patches. I didn't want him. Out of everyone, I wanted him to stay short the most, I think.
Right.
And, so, then, and also Mark McLaughlin. He's such an incredible poker player. We played a lot, and I had a really, really hard time with him. So I got lucky that he got coolered at the final table. Probably Benefield and Mark. I wanted to stay away from Mark as much as possible.
All right, here we got the ace-king offsuit. You coming in for a raise. If you see anything you want to describe, or if you have any memories of this, do let us know.
This is the second time in main event. I actually don't right now.
Good.
This is all kind of new for me. It's cool.
A former engineer putting chips together with 5-4 suited.
Amir is also a great player. There's some great players at this table.
Yeah, and it felt as though everyone was very prepared. Obviously, we didn't get to see much from Newhouse or Benefield, but the other players seemed very confident in their approach, which obviously helped them a lot.
Yeah. Yeah, I was probably one of the least prepared. I got very lucky to have won this, looking back at it, just considering these players were so good. They were more experienced, more prepared. It was just my day, I guess. I do remember this hand. Jay folds, and I think I go all in, and they both fold.
And if I'm Jay Farber, I've got to figure pocket nines are behind someone.
So tempting.
Yeah, I had a hard time with Mark.
Does opt not to get involved.
I'm sure I was not very excited right here.
Let's see how Reese, who was playing 1-2 no limit hold'em a year or so ago in Lansing, Michigan, processes all of this.
Reese with the better hand.
I wish it showed how many chips we had effective.
Right. Exactly what he did.
Farber getting a second opinion on his fold. Reese's 5-bet. And Reese putting chips together, a 5-bet to 11,100,000. And Leabut with 5-4 quickly folds. Now McLaughlin with ace 10.
Yeah, a 5-bet's going to make ace 10 feel like 7-deuce. If I'm McLaughlin, I try to make a deal right here with Reese. You know, give me a million chips back and I'll give you the pot.
You can't do that in a tournament. Cash, yes. And McLaughlin gives it up. And
so in this situation, do you recall your approach? Was it sort of like, we're gonna see where this goes? Were you ready to play for stacks? I mean, clearly, right now you're chip leader and you picked up, you know, maybe 10 million chips. So you must have had about 30 million effective or 30 million in front of you when the hand started, and you made it 11 million there.
Well, if I picked up 8 million, then I probably had like 37 million when the hand started.
Right.
So I don't know what my thought process was. It's funny. In this tournament on day 3, I 5-bet folded kings.
What?
Yeah. And the other guy had pocket kings. He told me after the fact. I didn't see his cards, but that's what he said. So like knowing that I did that in this tournament, like I hope I wouldn't have 5-bet folded there. Again, I was very I was very young and inexperienced, but I hope I would not have folded after five betting there, but you never know.
It's a crazy spot. You don't see a lot of five bets at the WSOP main event final table. Here comes Brummelhaus.
We were really deep.
Yeah, that's funny too. You say that really deep. I watched the big one for one drop final table with Dan Coleman the other day, and they had almost no chips at all to play with. Here's the nines. You pick up aces. Never a bad situation to be in.
Blind versus blind too.
Three raised to $3.2 million.
Brummelhaus, the first player from the Netherlands to make the main event final table. Our good friend Marcel Loos nearly did it. 14th in the 2003 main event. 10th in 2004.
Colin.
Colin.
Brummelhaus, here's the snap call signaling danger.
Yeah, blind on blind.
Wow,
just
what a cooler.
Luck for Brummelhaus.
Yeah.
Kind of impossible for him to get away from nines there in the blind battle.
Yeah, and I think he had 26 big blinds to start the hand. Can't do much there. He was expecting a child going into this final table. It was a cool storyline. So I thought going into it that he would be on the tighter side because of that. I think naturally most people would.
Has becoming a father changed your outlook on the game?
I definitely feel a little more pressure to win. Just because I have people that depend on me now to make money. But I don't know. I don't know if I've become tighter or looser because of it. I hope I'm still playing good.
I mean, clearly back in this moment, you know, you were the young kid with, you know, nothing really to worry or think about, which is probably an advantage to some degree, you know, having that fearlessness inside of you.
Oh yeah. Yeah, that's a incredibly underrated quality to have. You really need to be fearless. You can't be afraid of like pay jumps, or you can't be intimidated by other players. You need to kind of go in with the I'm the best attitude and I'm going to win this. I think that's really important in all aspects of life, but especially like a competitive thing like poker, or if you're a basketball player or whatever.
Right. All right, we're down to six players here with the departure of Michiel Brummelhaus in seventh place. Lots of interesting plays still left to be played. I'm here joined by Ryan Rees, watching the 2013 main event final table. If you like the show, if you enjoy what you're watching, please don't forget to like this video, subscribe to the channel, all that good stuff. It really helps us a lot. And if you've missed any of the previous episodes, please go back into our channel, into the archives, and find all of them, because they are well worth your time diving into these big main event final tables, along with some high-stakes poker cash game action. So plenty of stuff to dive into. All right, so you're a chip leader here, six-handed. It feels as though everything is going your way. Are you already dreaming about the millions of dollars, or, you know, are you able to sort of keep it level-headed there?
I feel like I was pretty level-headed. I don't think, again, this was a long time ago. This was what, seven, 8 years ago? But I feel like I did a really good job of not thinking about the money. I don't know how, but I think I did pretty good at it.
I feel as though that's sort of one of the crucial factors, is just, you know, being in that moment and not letting it affect you in any sort of way. Talk a little bit about, you know, JC Tran's perspective, if you have thoughts on that, because he came in as like the final table chip leader. Obviously, you know, the most well-known pro at the final table, and clearly having a lot to prove in that sense. Did you sort of feel his pain when nothing seemingly went to go his way the entire final table?
Yeah, it seemed like he was pretty card dead for the most part. He lost a few, like, he didn't lose any huge pots that I remember, but he wasn't winning pots. So, like, when the blinds keep going around, they keep going up, and he's just slowly like bleeding, it seemed like. And it seemed like he wasn't having a lot of fun at this final table, but at least he had a lot of chips to weather the storm early.
Right. And of course, you thought back then that you were going to win the main event once every 4 years, but we all know that, you know, making the final table just once is an enormous accomplishment. And it is one of those things, you know, you call someone a bracelet winner, but as far as the final table of the main event, you call someone a main event finalist, even if you finish ninth or seventh, like, it's still a massive accomplishment. As far as your position in the game of poker, did you feel as though when you won, and you said this in interviews, did you feel as though, you know, you really belonged in that top tier right away? Or was it more sort of like spirit of the moment, you know, you on cloud nine exclaiming that, you know, you are the best in the world?
And the best players in the world. And I think it's really important. I don't know if you've ever seen the Draymond Green clip where he talks about this. I'm good friend, not good friends, but I'm acquaintances with Draymond. We went to Michigan State together, same age. We graduated together. And he had a good quote regarding him saying that, like, he's the best basketball player in the world. And I think it's important to have that that mindset that you are the best, like, even if you're not the best at the time, I think it's important to have that like mindset in your head that you are the best, and then you will continue to work and get better to achieve that greatness that you have in your head. I don't know. I think it's really important. So at the time, I really believe looking back, I was not even in the top like 1,000 poker players in the world, in my opinion. Like, I have like a raw skill. I have good instincts and stuff, but as far as like from a fundamental standpoint, I was really bad, I think. But at the time, I believed I was one of the best. And I think if I didn't have that belief, that I wouldn't have won, wow, to be honest. I think it's really important to just have confidence. Because if you're out there and you're trying to compete against great players and you don't, like, think you belong there, it's going to be so hard to win. Because you're going to, like, second guess a lot of your decisions. You're going to be, like, timid and nervous. I don't know. That's just my own philosophy when it comes to that. When it comes to mindset and stuff like that.
But as that sort of works as a sliding scale, maybe your awareness of your skill level in relation to the opponents starts going down a bit and your realism goes up. How do you then find, you know, the right space again many, many years after this happens? So here you're on cloud nine, you're, you know, top level confidence, you think in your head that you're the best in the world, which really helps you. Then as that progresses and you become more aware of, you know, the players around you, perhaps your confidence goes down a little bit, but your skill goes up. How do you then find that balance again to be confident again, even though you got this extra dose of realism?
I think you just need to work harder. Once you get the extra dose of realism and you realize that, wow, I'm not as good as I thought I was, it should give you motivation to, because you can still reach that goal. Just because you're not as good at the time doesn't mean that, oh, okay, like, I'll find something else to do, you know? So you still have that goal that is attainable in your eyes, hopefully. And hopefully it just motivates you once you realize, like, oh, wow, like, when I first started hanging out with Alex Foxen, for instance, we would grind together all the time online, and we would travel together, stay with each other and play live stuff. I was like, this was before he was like the number one ranked player in the world. And I was like, oh my God, this guy's incredible. Like, he does stuff that I don't do. He's like on another level. And it really motivated me to be better, to reach out to people who are better than me, to learn, to incorporate new strategies, to be more fearless in spots, maybe less reckless in other spots. So I think realizing that maybe I'm not the best player in the world, but that's still a goal of mine and I still want to achieve that is important.
So it's a very stupid question, but I'm sort of curious what your answer is going to be. How much better are you now than you were 7 years ago?
Like, night and day. It's funny, but looking back, like, I mean, we'll see more hands that I played, but like from a fundamental standpoint, I didn't really know what I was doing. I had good instincts. Like, I had like some good bluffs and some good folds where I like stuff didn't really feel right. But no, I'm a lot better now than I was then.
That's a good sign though, because the game has changed so much that you have to really keep improving, yeah, to keep up. How do you look at that though? Because to me, it seems as though when you win the main event, the expectation is sort of like, oh, this guy's a lifer. He's going to play poker forever because he is the main event champion. But we've seen with people like P.S. Hines and Peter Eastgate that that's not really always the case. So when you won the main event, clearly you thought you'd be playing poker forever. But have you ever considered, you know, oh, maybe, you know, I've had my run, I've made some money, I can focus on something else? Or was that passion and excitement for the game that big that you knew you were going to be in poker for at least, you know, many years to come.
Yeah, I think I like to this day, I think I'm a lifer, to be honest. Like, I can't imagine a world where I would like miss playing the main event, like unless I had to for some reason. But I love the game so much. I love competing. I love being challenged. I kind of love not knowing what to do in some spots. Like, I was playing online yesterday, and it was one of my first hands in that 3200 that Joe McKeon won, my fellow main event champion. And I had a huge bluff, and I texted a friend. I was like, I really didn't know what to do in that spot. And it was kind of cool to me it's only a 2-card game, and it's like relatively solved, but there are some spots where you're still not going to know what to do. So I love the game. I love the challenge. I'm a very competitive person. I played basketball my whole life growing up, and once I realized I wasn't going to make it to the NBA, I wanted to find something else where I can compete at the highest level, and poker was it.
So as far as what your life looks like right now from a poker perspective, you know, how many hours do you play? Do you study? Do you have like groups of guys you talk to? Like, what's your approach to the professional side of, you know, your life?
Well, right now we're in quarantine still, kind of. But I'm playing all the WSOP events, and next month I'm going to go to Mexico and play some of the GG bracelet events as well. But like when we weren't in the full lockdown and we could travel and play poker, I was everywhere. I was going to my wife is European. She's Ukrainian. So I would spend a ton of time in Europe playing all the EPT events, different party poker events. I love traveling, and I love the game. So I'll always be around, unless I end up having too many kids to where I can't. you won't stop seeing me around at the poker tables.
That's awesome. Meanwhile, for the people paying attention to the action on the felt, we're seeing JC Tran getting pushed around first by Jay Farber, who 4-bets with pocket sixes, and then we see, 5-bets with pocket sixes against Tran's ace queen, who he threw in the muck, and now we see Tran going forward with the A7 to try to knock out Mark H.M. McLaughlin with ace king. So let's listen in on the showdown.
We're not used to seeing this. JC Tran coming a little unhinged. And if he does suck
JC
out one
three
time,
bet called this hand. Small blind versus button.
Yeah, he did.
All right, here's the flop. McLaughlin looking to hang on. Trey, Jack, Trey. JC likes the paired board.
Yeah, chance now they'll chop the pot. Mark Etienne still in great shape to double up.
Jonathan Duhamel looking closely on. Turned card, six of clubs, no help for Tran. McLaughlin, one card from a much needed double up.
Well, with a river, jack, or six, they would chop the pot. Only a seven knocks out Mark Etienne McLaughlin.
River card, the tray of diamonds, and McLaughlin doubles to 19 million.
Not a great double up from your perspective, obviously, giving someone a lot more chips who's young and aggressive and playing very well. JC now dropping down to fifth in chips after being the chip leader for, you know, quite a long time there leading into this final 7 battle, I believe. Play continues as far as the final table, what you remember from it. How exhausting was it? How long did it take? And what sort of stands out about, you know, the road to get down to heads up, let's say?
I actually wasn't exhausted at all. I mean, it's easier because back then there was a November 9, obviously, where we had 4 months off leading up to the final table. Now they just play it out. I think there's one day in between that they have off. So I was very fresh. I don't drink coffee. I don't drink any caffeine or take any like supplements. But when you're at this table, it's like in this spot, it's hard to really be tired. Like, you'd have to be dead inside to be tired because there's just so much adrenaline and excitement and everyone cheering. Like, it would be hard to be tired and to not be excited for such an incredible spot like this.
Let's see what Mark H. Chan finds. And yes, it is indeed Pocket Kings. Describe this hand from your perspective.
Yeah, so like I said before, Mark was the person who I least wanted to do well from a financial perspective from my own, because I thought that he was the best player at the table at the time. He's just very aggressive and fearless and very hard to play against. So this hand was very fortunate for everyone at the table, because I think most people felt the same way about Mark. I could be wrong. I don't want to speak for other people, but it would be hard. He's so good at poker that it would be impossible to think that he's not good. It's kind of like that.
Right.
But yeah, and this was such a cooler. They have almost 50 big blinds effective to start the hand.
It's so bizarre how one run of the cards, one cooler, kings versus aces, changes your life forever. And in the case of Mark Etienne, in the negative way, but in the case of Jay Farber, you know, this gave him so much ammunition that he could basically coast to heads up play. And for you, playing heads up against Jay, you know, if we're thinking about this in a reverse scenario, is probably a much better scenario given his experience than playing heads up against Mark Etienne.
Yeah, just completely different. I mean, Jay doesn't really have, at the time, he didn't really have much experience playing poker. And at least tournament poker, heads up poker. And Mark, like, played online all the time, and he's very aggressive. And it would have been a completely different, I hope I still would have won, but I was on the very good side of card distribution heads up. So maybe against Mark, I also would have won based on that. But it definitely would have been a different battle.
One time.
Mark Etienne using his one time under my rules.
Mark is so positive even after this.
He is, and he even seems relaxed, maybe sort of resigned to his fate, but also, I don't know, there was still a glimmer of hope there.
Yeah. His rail was fun during this whole experience too.
Yeah, the Larry Walker chant, which we haven't really seen and paid attention to, but the couple times that he got a walk, there was a huge chant from his rail, which was really, really cool.
And when he received walks, I was actually on the button, so a lot of those were due to me not raising.
Right.
To Jonathan Duhamel's 2010 title.
And this impressive main event run from McLaughlin, his best ever, earns him over $1.6 million. Boy, that hand lit up this Penn and Teller Theater. Amateur Jay Farber has seized the chip lead at this championship table.
Wow, he had half the chips, five-handed.
Wow, that's insane. All right, there's Mark Etienne McLaughlin talking about losing the hand with kings against aces. Ryan, you had a giant rail here during the final table. You said it earlier, over 100 people came out to support you. Like, who were these people? Where did they all come from? And how did you manage to arrange having them all in that room?
So I had a lot of family members, aunts, uncles, cousins, parents. A lot of them had a small piece of me, like they had 1% here, 2% there. So they all came out for the rail. And then a lot of just friends that I met on the WSOP circuit, which is what I was playing in the months prior to in the spring, I guess, of 2013. And that was like Lonnie and Phil, Jared Ludeman, Sean Daniels, all those guys were out there. And then I also had like friends from high school, friends from college. So I kind of had people from everywhere. And they all came out to watch me, and all their collective run good was what helped me, I think. Good vibes.
I know that we are nowhere near the end of this final table, but I do want to touch upon having a $8 million win with over 100 friends in town. What happened that night or the following night to celebrate this win?
So nothing too crazy, believe it or not. Back then, if you won the main event, they gave you a presidential suite at the Rio, which is in that hallway if you're walking from the hotel to like the convention center. And they catered food and drinks and stuff. And I ended up getting really drunk really fast. So I think I only lasted 4 hours or something and I was out. So I know some other people, they might have went out to the club or they might have partied after, but for me personally, it didn't last very long. And then the next day I had a lot of interviews and stuff to do. So I was kind of I was slammed with all the media the next day. So I didn't really have a huge party. I'm not a huge party person. I like to just hang out with like a small group of friends. But yeah, it was pretty relaxed. I'm sure other winners have different stories than I do.
Well, most people tell me that they're just too exhausted to even have a party. They're just like, you know, this was so tiring and so taxing that, you know, they never got around to having a proper party. Here we see JC Tran getting eliminated by Jay Farber with the A7 against King Queen. A7 twice the hand that cost JC Tran a ton of chips. He gets fifth for $2.1 million, and all of a sudden we are four-handed. And I feel as though we have barely seen anything from Amir Lahavat or Sylvain Loosely. They seem to just be sitting around while you, Ryan, and Jay Farber were dishing out the heavy blows at this final table. When you get down to four-handed, things get really serious. The millions of dollars start creeping up. The payout jumps, you know, become more significant. But at the same time, you know, if you've already guaranteed yourself $3 million, then it's clearly a very relaxing situation to be in. Here we got a big all-in. Loosely all-in with Queen 7 off, and there you are with Ace 10. So let's listen in.
Main event champion. He's the third from France to make the final table. Marc Bouchard was eighth in 1998.
This all went pretty quickly. I know we only played, I think it was one hand of three-handed play. I'm pretty sure Loosely and Amir bust back-to-back hands.
Wow.
So, which was kind of nice for me because it... Say hi. Say hi.
Hi.
Hi. Do you see Daddy on TV?
Needs to pair up on the river or be gone.
You can watch his hand, then you gotta
look.
Go, okay?
Oh, I see my dad.
There he is.
Only a queen or a seven saves his main event. Will we soon be three-handed? Loosely looking for a miracle. The river card Loosely comes up empty, and his main event adventure comes to a close in fourth place.
This is you and him. This is my friend Ren. But you gotta go, baby. We gotta finish this, okay? I'll go swimming with you when I'm done, okay?
Sylvain Loosely. All right, there he is. The daughter came checking in on that to make sure that you still indeed did win this hand, because who knows? Butterfly effect, you never know.
Yeah.
Loosely gone. You are up to second in chips again. I guess you stayed there because you grabbed some more chips there. $64 million, and then is now three-handed with Amir Lahavat, sort of, you know, jumping another pay jump and just loving life right now. There are the chip counts: $105 million, $64 million, and $21 million. Clearly a massive, massive lead for Jay Farber. And it seems as though, as I pause the screen, you're looking at those very standings right now up on the big screen.
Yeah. And then this... There should be another bust out this hand, and then we're done for the day. So it was back then, the first day, we went from 9 people down to 2, I believe.
Oh, of course. That makes total sense.
Yeah, and then because nowadays they break it into 3 days. But back then it was only 2.
Yeah, or they stop down to 3 players and do it in 2 sessions. So
yeah,
playing down heads up is quite risky because heads up could only last one hand, and then you have no broadcast.
Yeah, but we were really deep when heads up started. I think we are at 70 big blinds effective, something like that.
Here we go with the tens against the sevens against Lahavat. So who did you have there on your closest rail? Clearly I see some poker faces that I recognize. Was that, you know, just a coaching team, or did you also, like, I've heard different things. Some people want their family close, some people want their family, you know, not too close because of the emotions that it stirs up having them so close to you. So how did you pick who was like right behind you there?
So as people bust out, their cheering section's empty, and then people from mine that were in like the grandstands, they slowly filled up like the area right behind me. So as I'm playing, I didn't really have much of a say as to who is back there, but I just know that I had like 10 friends or so in the front that were helping me with the hands, like Phil and Lonnie and Jared, I think were the three main people, if my memory serves me correctly, that I would go to for hands. And then I had like my girlfriend at the time and my parents and stuff. They were like a couple rows back because I don't need to talk to them in between hands to figure out what other people have. So that's how I personally, I just wanted to talk to the people who were helping me like through the decision making.
Right, that makes total sense. All right, Bruce Buffer. We cannot skip Bruce Buffer.
Introducing first, a 23-year-old from Las Vegas by way of Lansing, Michigan, with approximately 85 million in chips. He is Reese the Beast, Ryan Reese.
As a lifelong sports fan, how cool was that?
So cool. It's funny. Another thing that Bruce did for me, when my daughter, my second daughter, was born last year, he did a baby announcement for her, which is really, really cool. I didn't even know he was doing it, but one of my friends had him do it for me and reached out. It was really cool. I'm a huge UFC fan and sports fan in general. So it was extra special.
I feel as though this should be a thing every year.
Yeah. They stopped doing it for, I don't know how many years he did it, but Bruce loves poker. And I'm sure, I don't know why, maybe he's more expensive now than he used to be or something. But he's a huge poker fan, so they should bring him back.
I agree. I think it's awesome. I think it adds to the element of this big stage, you know, the bracelet on the table, all the cash, and then you guys two battling it out for millions of dollars. Jay Farber had the advantage as far as the chips go here coming into heads up play, but you busting Amir made a huge difference as far as closing that gap just a little bit. The bracelet and the cash in the middle, did it add anything extra to the experience of playing here for the title?
Yeah, I'm sure it definitely did. Again, I tried to not focus on that as much as possible. But yeah, it's hard when you're sitting right next to millions and millions of dollars and you're a young kid to not pay attention to it. But, I tried my best to stay focused at the task at hand.
So as we get into heads up play here, and we have a lot of hands to cover, please chime in whenever you see something you remember or something you notice, from this heads up battle, because clearly you guys played for quite a while.
Yeah, we played 91 hands, I believe. I think that's something like that. Because I know I raised every button, which is interesting. But all 45 buttons I had, or 46 buttons I raised, which probably wouldn't have done that now, but it worked.
Yeah, that is really funny. Did you get specific coaching or tips as far as heads up play and as far as, you know, your opponent? Because clearly you had, you know, one night and a whole morning to discuss.
Yeah, I really don't remember the specific advice I had, so I can't talk about that because I just don't remember. But I'm sure they told me a lot of things, whether it was live tells or just certain tendencies, betting patterns that he has that I used to help me. But it was kind of tough to play against Jay because he's not playing GTO. He's doing like his own thing. So when you're playing heads up against someone, it's hard to really give them a range for certain hands when you don't really know what they're doing. So again, I think I was on the good side of card distribution for this, which really helps.
The bracelet in the middle, and we see you pick up a hand here early. The bracelet in the middle, where did it end up? Where did it go? Did you get a chance to show it off? And clearly, because of its actual value, it must be a tough thing to sort of carry around.
Yeah, mine's in at the bank in a box, because the value of it is too high to not have it there. So yeah, I go and visit it and look at it and wear it every now and then, but I don't. It never leaves the bank.
That's kind of a shame, though, isn't it? Like you have this amazing trophy, and I know you have trophies in the same room where you're sitting right now. You have this amazing trophy, but you can't really show it off or display it.
Yeah. Yeah, like some people were thinking about getting like a replica made out of like cubic zirconium or something instead of diamonds. You could do something like that so you have it at home, which it would obviously have way less value. But yeah, it's kind of a shame, but what can you do?
Right.
I know other champions have had theirs stolen from ex-girlfriends, and I don't want to be a target. So
right, no, it makes total sense because it is like actually made with diamonds, which is kind of nuts if you think about it. I mean, in the old days,
the value of it was 500,000. They said at the time,
holy shit!
Yeah, it was the most expensive trophy in all of sports, individual trophy in all of sports. When I won it, I don't know if that has changed, but kind of a cool stat.
Wow. That is a really cool stat. I had no idea. I mean, that is ridiculous. I mean, so you, okay, so they hand you the bracelet, you get to take pictures with it, and you were like, please keep this here because I don't want to like leave the room with it.
Yeah, I don't remember what, I definitely didn't take it that night. I think I might have picked it up the next day and then just took it straight to the bank. Oh, I remember this hand. I got lucky this hand.
All right, tell me.
Kind of lucky. My 3-bet preflop and C-bet somehow checked the turn. I must have had a bad feeling or something, but I remember getting lucky on the river. I think I river an ace.
Farber with a bet of 8.2 million with his sevens and fours.
Farber's got Reese on the hook now. But yeah, I could not have been top kicker with that board. It's hard because there were no draws on the flop really. So when Jay bets the turn, there was no flush draw on the flop. Jay's not really someone to float me with like a 9-10 suited type hand on the flop. So I wasn't very happy about it, but I got lucky. I got lucky a lot this tournament.
That's what you have to do, man. That's what you have to do. I'm lucky in life too, but not with cards. So it's different kind of luck. This is interesting too. Like you decide to lead him on the river. Was that because you thought of his range as something that must have value in it? Therefore, you know, all those 2-pair combos obviously get counterfeit on the river. But you know, could you think that he might have weaker aces that he's always willing to pay off with, but he would not bet as much as you would bet? Like what do you think was the process there?
I don't really know why I led there. That's why it's funny going back and looking back at hands when I just wasn't as good at poker, and I do stuff. It's like, why did I do that? It may have been as like a blocker bet. Maybe I didn't want him to like go all in because he could have easily had like ace eight, ace four, ace seven. He could have had full houses, pocket fours, because it was a 3-bet pot. So I don't know why I led there, honestly. Looking back at it, if the hand played itself again, I would have checked.
Right.
But at the time, I bet.
Let's talk a little bit about your look. You're wearing the Detroit Lions Megatron Calvin Johnson jersey. I will never forget. I was watching this final table. I was live tweeting. I wasn't in Vegas at the time. But Bill Simmons chimed in. Megatron Nowitzki. Nowitzki because of the hair, and Megatron because of the Calvin Johnson jersey. Explain the wardrobe choice and also talk about, you know, receiving information that, you know, the whole world was watching.
Yeah, that was kind of cool. I remember watching a Lions game. I don't know if I was watching it on TV or if I was at the game, but it was earlier that year. It was a couple months prior. It must have been in September or October or something. And I think Calvin Johnson had 3 touchdowns in a game or something crazy, or he had like a game-winning touchdown. And after that, I said, I think I'm going to wear a Calvin jersey. Like, I was watching the game, and in that moment, I decided that's what I was going to wear. And it was kind of cool. I never ended up meeting him or anything. He had a relatively short career, considering how good he was in his prime. But it was cool. I like my wardrobe choice at the time. And if and when I ever make the main event final table again, I'll wear another jersey, but it'll be a basketball jersey this time.
Wow. Are you a Pistons fan, or is it going to be college basketball?
I don't know who the jersey is going to be. I have a lot of different options. But yes, I am a Pistons fan, a big Pistons fan.
I'm sorry to hear that.
Hey, we were really good in the early 2000s, early to mid 2000s.
Yeah, I mean, as a Raptors fan, and seeing that whenever the Raptors play in Detroit, there's more Raptors fans than Detroit fans is just really funny to see.
Yeah, I'm sure it's that way now. It was like that the opposite for the Red Wings back in the day. If you would go to Red Wings games, and I went to a Red Wings game in Nashville, and it was like 70% Wings fans. It's kind of crazy, but certain teams travel better than others.
Yeah, that's really true. As far as the online, I guess, excitement, you know, and Twitter being sort of at its early peak when this was all going down, and it was live, of course, on ESPN, and then Bill Simmons chiming in, who is also, you know, a big name in sports. Did you catch wind of how big this was becoming on social media?
So I actually opened up a Twitter account in May. So like right before the WSOP started, I think I was going out there and I found out like, oh, all poker players have Twitter. This is how people, this is how you hear about tournaments, chip counts, poker information, basically. If you're a poker player, a tournament poker player, you kind of need to have Twitter or else you're going to miss some stuff. And, this was a really interesting hand, actually.
All right, let's do the hand first and then get back to Twitter.
Yeah, this is a really Farmer good. Checks.
Ryan Reese looks at his...
Probably the most chip. Interesting hand at the final table, in my opinion.
All right, describe to me why.
Because, so I raised preflop and Jay just defended, which was pretty standard, seeing that these are the hands. And I see bet and Jay just called. And the turn was, let's wait for the turn. I think it's a nine, but I haven't seen this in so long. And Jay check raised me. Oh, it's a two. Yeah, and a nine would have made more sense, actually. It was 6-5. But now Jay decides to check raise me. And he hasn't done anything like this ever since I've played with him. Not earlier in the tournament, not at the final table. He didn't really take check raises as bluffs. He played very like solid and tight. But on the turn, I thought I thought something was up. I thought I had the best hand, but it's so hard to find a bluff for him when the turn's a two of clubs, you
right?
Know? Unless he has like a four or five of clubs, or yeah, I guess he could have like ace four of clubs, ace five of clubs. There are like some club combos, but not many non-club combos other than 4-5, or if he's doing it with like 6-5 and 6-4. But I didn't think that he would check raise me with 6-5 offsuit, no, with no flush draw here. But on the turn, I thought I had the best hand, to be honest. And the river didn't change much, so I still should have thought there's the nine that I was anticipating.
So 38 million in the middle here.
Barber's trying to I don't remember how much he bet. Maybe Reese half pot or something. Look at this. 23 million, maybe? He might have bet big.
Dry on this bluff.
Yeah.
Barber bets 24.5 million.
So what's racing through your mind right now?
So honestly, I tanked for like 6 minutes here. And I thought I had the best hand. It's hard to find a bluff, but something... I just didn't think he had a three for whatever reason. Maybe I thought he would have check raised a three on the flop. But there was something in me. I was like, I thought I had the best hand, but I remember my thought process at the time. I don't know if this is good or not, but I thought I had an edge heads up. So I thought if I fold here, I still have a good chance of winning the tournament. If I fold, whether he bluffed me or not, if I fold, I still thought I had a good chance of winning the tournament. I think we would have been about even. Maybe he would have had a tiny bit more than me. If I call and lose, I didn't trust myself to not tilt to some degree. Because like, I didn't want to like call and lose and then be tilted. Then he has a lot more chips than me. And then I'm like, it's because like I fold and we still have about the same stack.
Right.
He has 99, I have 90. So I thought that by me folding and losing, that I would still win the tournament a good amount of the time. And if I call and lose, then I have, what would that be, 55 million to his 150 million, roughly, 140 million. And I thought that it would be really tough for me to win the tournament if I call and lose. So I decided to take the less variance route and just fold and see another hand. But I really thought I had the best hand. But it was just hard for me to find a bluff. Very, very interesting hand. But I've thought about that one a lot.
But the cool thing from my perspective is that that decision shows how much confidence you had, where you were not hanging up your whole event to one call being right or wrong. You were just ready to battle, and you were telling yourself, look, there's more value in folding than there is in calling.
Yeah. Exactly. I basically, in my head, like doing nothing scientifically, but I basically tried to weigh like the the future value of all three options of calling and winning. Then I'm going to win the tournament a ton because I'm going to have a lot of the chips. Calling and losing, then I'm not going to win the tournament that often at all. And just by folding, I still thought I would win the tournament a lot.
Wow.
So that was my thought process at the time.
I mean, for a 23-year-old kid playing his first main event and, you know, sitting under the bright lights here playing for millions of dollars, that might be the most impressive thing of this entire final table.
Yeah, even though I was wrong, kind of.
But that doesn't matter. Like, you didn't get to see his card, so that doesn't really matter. Yeah, really matter.
That's true. But I actually found out about his cards shortly after that he had 6-5. And I think that because I found out that he had 6-5, that is where this hand comes into play. Because I also have the 6-5. And after the hand, I remember we went over to the rails and I said something to Chance because Chance was on Jay's rail. I said something about having 6-5. But here I check called flop, check called turn, and led the river, which is just crazy. But I thought it was the only way I would win. I didn't think check raising the turn makes much sense because I wouldn't check raise if I had a full house. And I didn't want Jay to not fold. But I didn't think Jay had anything. So I just check called and then bet the river. I thought it was the only way I win the pot.
So you were,
but again, something that I would never do now, but it's just funny to see.
So you're actively trying to find creative ways to get him off his hand. Like, that's awesome.
Yeah, because on the turn, I didn't think he had anything, but I didn't want to check raise because then he could like re-raise. Then I'm like giving him a chance to win the pot. But so I thought if I just check call and then just bet the river, he doesn't have anything. He has to fold. Does throw a shadow and there's no draws out there, so I can't really have any bluffs. There's no flush draws, no straight draws. But it's so funny because I would never do that nowadays. But it worked. So maybe I should bring that back.
Yeah, exactly. Bring back the unpredictability and the funny lines in that sense. Yeah. Oh, like let's hear.
I'm more than okay with that.
We're in Waterford, Michigan right now, and this is where Ryan grew up. It's a special place for him.
You know, he went to the same high school that his dad went to, so that's always been, you know, a special thing for him.
Well, here is Our Lady of the Lakes, where I went to high school. It's a Catholic school. Sister Fran, she actually liked me a lot. I played poker here.
He just passed away from coronavirus, Sister Fran.
Oh, no way.
Rest in peace. Yeah, she was awesome.
Wow, that's horrible, man. I'm so sorry to hear that.
Half of the money they make goes to charity, the other half goes to the people who own it.
What's up, Johnny?
I asked him, I was like, hey, what do you want to do with your life? And he said, I want to be a professional poker player.
First time I ever played cash games was here.
Our biggest goal is not only to achieve success for ourselves, but to show people that if you believe in it, you visualize it, it'll happen.
He's always been pretty confident. He's he sets his mind to something, and that's what he does.
He said, I'm going to graduate first, and then I'm just going to travel the world and, you know, just enjoy it, and maybe I can make some money along the way.
I'm 23 years old, and it's the first main event I played.
Let's go, baby.
My son, who I love dearly, and who is such an awesome guy.
Reese the Beast!
That's cool.
What's it like to see that, man?
It's cool. It brings back great memories. I was at my friend Dylan's house, and he's in the Marine Corps. So he's been in Okinawa for the last few years. He's a pilot for the Marines. So I haven't seen him in years. I miss him.
Wow. That's a long distance for sure.
Yeah.
As far as, you know, this moment for you being the main event champion, it's also just a giant anchor point as far as memories go for you and your family, and, you know, something to look back on and always cherish as a memory. Do you allow yourself, you know, to savor that and to think back of how special it all was, or is it sort of like a thing of the past and now you're seeing it now, it brings it all back, but it's not something you are, you know, actively thinking about?
I don't think about it too much. It was a while ago. And I mean, I guess I don't like actively think about it because it was maybe a while ago and it's kind of like out of sight, out of mind. But it's amazing. Like, thank you for having me do this because it's really cool to go back and relive the hands, relive the interviews, and kind of put myself back in that, in the position that I was in, considering I don't relive it that often. So it's really cool.
That's awesome, man. And then, you know, your daughter who was just on the show with us, 20 years from now, she can watch this show and be like, oh, wow, that's kind of cool. Like, look at this through a whole different kind of way.
Yeah, that's cool. I'm glad she did a little cameo for us.
Exactly. Here you got Pocket Jacks on 8-4-3 against Jay's Ace 4. Those look like raising chips. It seems as though you were just hyper aggressive whenever it was like top pair or over pair or you making big hands.
Jay actually 4-bet this hand.
Sorry? Wow, I missed that. I was too busy listening to you, but that's crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, which is crazy because he didn't do anything like that prior. But yeah, he opened, I 3-bet, he 4-bet, I called, and then I check called flop. And now here's the turn. But yeah, this is actually a 4-bet pot, which I think was the only time Jay 4-bet the whole.
That's nuts. So we got Farber here sticking in 13.6 million chips.
I like the way Reese is playing this hand, getting a bunch of value for his pocket jacks. He's turning the Lon McCarron Memorial hand into a pot of gold.
And here I wasn't very happy, obviously.
I mean,
but we're not folding. Our hand's way too good, but you can't be, if against someone who has never done anything like that before, you can't be too thrilled, you know?
Right.
But I know when he checked back to the river, I instantly tabled my hand and was very happy. Before he even showed his cards. I do remember that.
That was a
because
very.
Because I knew that he's not going to check back a better hand on the river. So
that was a very aggressive fist pump. What was the battle between you guys like? There's no table talk. Like, was there any animosity? Was there any sort of, I don't know, friendship over this moment? Like, how do you look back on the heads up battle in that sense?
I had no animosity. I hope he didn't. But I know that there was some trash talk between the rails. And I know I had a few friends that were pretty drunk that may have said some mean things to Jay or to people on his rail and vice versa. But between me and Jay, there was no animosity, no like beef or anything. But I know the rails were going at it the whole time because this was a long heads up session and like people pregame for this, you know? So like you wake up at 10 o'clock, it's like, all right, let's start drinking. Final table's at 2. So people are, people really were getting ready for this. And there were, I don't know. Yeah, I mean, he had a ton of people there too. I know Dan Bilzerian, Chance, Sean Deeb, Jesse Sylvia. He had tons of people on his rail. So it was kind of, there was a battle between me and Jay on the table. And then there was also the battle of the rails in the background. And it was in Penn and Teller Theater. So it was really cool. It's a really, really cool thing to be a part of. I hope one day we can play back in the Penn and Teller Theater again because it's really something special.
This seems to me like a 6-bet. Maybe I'm not keeping track of this correctly, but it looked like 2 million, 5 million, 9.5 million. You made it 17.5, and he threw away his pocket fives, just going after with the ace jack.
Yeah, I don't know what my plan was there, but. I think that might have been a 5-bet.
A 5-bet, yeah, you're right.
Yeah, and maybe because I know that Jay 4-bet the ace 4 offsuit prior, maybe that's why I chose to 5-bet there. But again, like, if he shoves, I don't know what my plan was, to be honest. Oh, I guess I was calling because he only has 18 million left.
I was going to say, we are now in a stage where you have 172 million chips sitting there with 2 stacks. That's when you know life's good, when you have 2 separate stacks and you have to guide your one arm in between those 2 stacks.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, huge moment. You seem very confident all the way throughout. Jay Farber on the ropes here. Was it harder to keep focused the closer you got, or was it more so like, I got to close this out before I can allow myself to feel anything?
Yeah. I was definitely very motivated to finish the job. There was no premature celebration on my end. And I actually thought that this was going to be it. I thought this was going to be the end.
So this hand, you have it all in with top pair against his straight draw. He's got a backdoor. Or actually, he doesn't have a backdoor. I thought he had spades, but he doesn't. What is a moment like this like where you're on the brink? Do you recall this moment?
I do. Yeah, and I thought I was going to win. You can see the tears in my eyes forming already. But the night on the turn, it wasn't meant to be, and we had a little bit more poker to play. I remember not being too, because as you can see at this final table, everything went really smoothly the whole time for me. Really, I like won the flips early. I won the flips. The hands I was dominated, I won. Everything went pretty. There wasn't any. Everything was just easy. It wasn't hard. So this was the first time that something didn't go my way, kind of, where like it quote unquote should have, because I had the best hand. But I remember not being too down about it. Part of me felt like it shouldn't be this easy. You know what I mean? Like I'm just getting all the cards, but give me a little bit of animosity. Let me earn it. So I feel like that's where that nine came from.
We cut to the following hand where Farber has a flush draw against your queen jack on king three deuce. They cut out the preflop action from this hand right after commercial to making it seem even more so like a live event, like we're tuning right back in here on the turn. As far as becoming the main event champion and, you know, being on national TV for that many hours, what was the aftermath like going back to normal life, walking through casinos or airports and, you know, just being Ryan Reese, the world champion for that whole year?
Yeah, like whenever I was in Michigan, for instance, like when I was at Michigan State University, whenever I'd go back for like a football game or basketball game, a lot of people would recognize me. I would go to Lions games and tons of people would recognize me. Also in casinos, obviously. But if I wanted to walk into like Best Buy or something, like no one's, or maybe people are going to recognize me, but it's going to be way less often and people probably aren't going to come up to me and say something. So I know Phil Ivey had a quote back in the day, said that like he could go into a Walmart and no one would recognize him. No one would say anything to him. Right. And this was like when he was in the prime. I don't know how often he was shopping at Walmart in his prime, but but it's kind of funny. Like poker is such a niche community. So like when you're in the poker room, you're a celebrity, but outside of it, you're kind of like a normal person.
So it's kind of like the right level of fame. Like you don't have to like cater your whole life around it, but when you're in the poker rooms, you know, you're still a guy that people like to talk to or, you know, take pictures with and stuff like that.
Yeah, which is awesome. Like I love it. I've never said no to a picture in my life. I've talked to all the fans and stuff. I think it's not something that I have to do, but I embrace it and I enjoy it. And if there can be like a kid that looks up to me that wants to be a poker player, again, I wouldn't really recommend people to be a professional tournament poker player because there's just so much variance involved and it's hard. But if I can motivate someone to do it, like all the props to them, I hope they end up winning the main event.
That's the right mentality, man. We love hearing that. Here goes Jay Farber betting $13 million. You're making the call here with Queen High, quite optimistic. You just didn't believe it, huh?
I guess not. Yeah. And I wonder if it had to do with me losing that pot prior. Remember I said I didn't tilt and then I do this, which is very out of character for me. So maybe there was a little bit of tilt losing the King 10 to Jack 10. But again, I still have a lot of chips and I still made it happen. But yeah, some of his bluffs could beat me. He could have like ace four and ace five and beat me with some bluffs. I can't be much there at all, but we were battling.
You got to be a hero sometimes. And if it works out, it makes for great TV. So, yeah. And at least you had the chips to do it with because you still have that 2-1 chip lead. Despite doubling him up and then gifting him all these chips, you still have him 2-1, which obviously, you know, is the best possible scenario.
Yeah. But at this point, it probably was getting kind of you don't want to be a 10-1 chip favorite in the main event heads up and let it get away. So there's like right here maybe is when the most nerves kicked in, to be honest, because you don't want to squander an opportunity like that. You never know when you're going to get it again.
Right. Here we got Farber with the top pair. You got the middle pair. Still strong hand with the top kicker in heads-up play.
Michigan, its second main event champion in the last 5 years. Joe Catta, of course, winning it in 2009.
83 world champ and recent Hall of Fame inductee Tom McAvoy, also from Michigan. Reese will come along for $3 million.
We're overdoing Maryland to win another main event.
Turn card is the ace, and Reese's run good is clicking on all cylinders, turning aces up. He checks again.
I don't understand much about
some things are just meant to be, Remco. I believe in that.
This is the ultimate proof.
Yeah.
Farber just with a pair of jacks reaching 5.6.
Like Toronto, there was no way the Raptors were losing.
No.
You know? It just wasn't happening. It wasn't going to win every time.
Exactly. And there was no way the Lions were going to win anything, so You're the most successful person in a Lions jersey in like the last 40 years.
Ever, yeah.
Ever.
The Lions have never made it to the Super Bowl. It's funny. They actually won the World Championship of football the year before Super Bowl I.
It's
so, like, the Lions won, and they're like, okay, we got to start something else. Let's start this thing called the Super Bowl.
Exactly. Let's go on with a new tradition. It's no longer worth anything if the Lions have won it.
Yeah.
All right, so here you get some of your momentum back.
I check raise the turn, yeah?
Yeah. Or you just raise the turn, I guess, when he continued betting. But yeah. definitely momentum shift back to you, grabbing some chips after doubling him up and losing that big stack. It's cool to see how this heads-up battle, you know, really could have gone Jay's way now that we're seeing this again. Like, you're hitting a lot of good hands, and
yeah.
And in the beginning, he started with the chip lead, obviously. That big bluff that worked on you was a big one for his confidence as well. So from that perspective, quite an even match, so to say. But then there in the middle where you grabbed the chip lead, you started sort of having that big advantage that you never really let go of despite doubling him up. And I feel as though he always seemed to be under more pressure because he could not get back to even.
Yeah. Yeah, he was he started off the heads up battle down. So he kind of the entire time he was kind of trying to climb out of that hole and like gain his chip lead back, and I was just getting better cards at him. Like, sometimes that's what it comes down to. There's not much he could do. Like, if I was in his situation and the cards are reversed, I probably don't win. It would have been really hard, you know.
You mentioned earlier that you would
this is a fun hand.
Oh, okay.
Like, we were just, as the heads up battle progressed, we just started battling more and more. Like, in the beginning, we were kind of tight, and now it's like, well, we just started out leveling each other. Like, I know you don't have an ace because you wouldn't have raised with an ace. You would have just called. And now if I have an ace, I'm just going to call. I'm not going to re-raise you. I want to keep your bluffs in. So we just started floating each other with pretty bad hands.
There's 20 million in the middle with the old 10-5 against 5-3 suited. I love it.
And a pot that was check raised on the flop. Like, it's so fun.
Reese follows up though.
But this is, I love watching this because it takes me back into my mindset when I was not like trying to play like a GTO bot and like just looking at the person. And like, back then there were no solvers. The game was so different than it is now. So you really just like went to war. There was no GTO. There was no, this is what you need to do in this spot. It was like, okay, like, I don't think you have it, or I think you have it. Like, this is my play. It's kind of cool.
That's how I play in $1, $2 cash games.
Yeah, it's good. I wish I could go back. Part of me wishes that I could have the same poker mind back then, or like right now, as I did back then, even though I think I'm a way better player now. It's kind of cool to just have like, to be very raw. I think it's a good thing.
Right.
And I think that's why a lot of poker players, they'll be really successful when they start playing. Like, I don't know how many other players are out there like me where their first hand in mob cash is a big score, but I don't know off the top of my head, but there are other ones where like, they started playing and they just have like some raw innate ability or talent that lets them do good, and they do good because of it. But like, from a fundamental standpoint, they're not very good.
Right. Well, I do think that it also plays into being young and just having an appetite for risk, which, you know, that fearless element really helps, especially when you're playing a big event, getting to put pressure on players. So, you know, I think all those things come together really well at this final table, where you clearly had all those things in this blend that worked so well for you.
Yeah.
All right, here he gets hit really hard again. You pick it up with trips there. For the people who are watching the show, by the way, I forgot to address you here for quite some time, but don't forget to like this video and subscribe to the channel, share with your friends, and let them know that Run It Back is covering all the biggest final tables in the world of poker right here on the Facebook page of Poker Go and the Poker Central YouTube channel. Reese sitting on 176 million. Farber back down to 14 million, despite having a string of hands that really went well for him, and now you got him chipped all the way down, waiting for that final blow to hoist the trophy.
That last hand was the first time that Jay, I don't know if you noticed, but it was the first time he got kind of it's like the wind came out of his sails, like how he said call. He was kind of over it after that last hand, and then he does this, which is something that he probably normally wouldn't. Not I'm not saying this is bad, but maybe if he was not as, I mean, he was just running bad. Maybe if he wasn't running bad, he would have just defended this hand, for instance. But yeah, what a battle. Very cool to relive it.
He still has 34% despite the Ace King of Hearts looking oh so strong.
I mean, whatever. Five's my favorite card in the deck, so I'm just here with the Five of Hearts.
Whatever.
And the Five of Diamonds. I don't actually care.
Ryan Reese on the verge of $8.3 million.
He checks the Jack 10 and like
that hand. When that hand was an iron, I had a pair, but like he.
All right, the flop four Jack 10. Reese with a Broadway draw, stealing Farber's queen.
Yeah, that flop cuts Farber's outs in half. A queen now would give Ryan Reese an ace high straight.
As you mentioned, Reese all in on day seven for just 10 big blinds. But now, so close to winning it all. A tray on the turn. No help for Farber.
Let's go.
Farber deflated and about to be defeated.
So much respect to him.
Absolutely.
Like, seriously.
You didn't need to go
every match. What happened?
Tears already in the eyes of Ryan Reese with one card to come.
Ryan Reese needs to dodge a five on the river, and the main event championship will be his.
The river card is a four!
Yes!
Ryan Reese is the world champion!
Incredible scenes here.
So cool.
Ryan Reese said he was the best player here, and he said he would win. By golly, he did.
The Beast!
I could run like you, buddy. Well played.
An amazing main event performance.
The ultimate quote for someone who just outlasted every single player except for the final one.
Ryan Reese announced to the world that he would win this title, and he has turned doubters into believers. For Jay Farber, a payday of almost $5.2
million. He ran amazing. What are you going to do?
He made every hand. Like, every single hand.
He had the best hand ever.
I know.
Complaining when you finish second in the main event is just because of the competitive spirit, obviously, but Jay Farber ran really pure as well, outside of the fact that he lost and ran into you here in the heads-up battle. What's it like seeing, you know, these moments here as you, you know, get mobbed by friends and family?
It's really cool. It's really cool to be back in that space. I want to go back after reliving this. This is extra motivation to make it back if it's possible to need more.
All right, let's watch the ceremony here and see what's being said.
You came in as the amateur at the table, but certainly didn't play like one. Can you talk to us about this ride here for the heads up?
It's been an incredible experience. Nothing but the most fun. I had a great time this whole time.
Unfortunately, I just couldn't get any cards today, and you know, he made a bunch of hands and played better than me. So, congratulations, Ryan's a great player. Happy for him to win.
And now it is time for the bracelet presentation, and I'm going to throw this over to Jason Arashabin, who designed this beautiful bracelet.
Wow.
It is our honor here at Jason of Beverly Hills to present the 2013 World Series of Poker Championship Bracelet. Greg, will you do the honors?
Show the camera, show the camera.
It looks like this is an emotional moment for you. Can you let us in on how this feels for you?
It feels amazing. First, I want to thank God. Without God, I wouldn't be able to be here. I want to thank my family, my friends, for the best rail in the entire world, and everybody who's been supporting me. And a big hats off to Jay. He played for good. He was a tough competitor.
All the way, you've had this incredible certainty that you are going to win this. What gave that to you?
I just think I'm the best player in the world.
It's an amazing thing. 10 years on from the time you watched Chris Moneymaker raise this bracelet, you're raising it again. This is our new world champion. Raise that bracelet, Ryan. Congratulations.
Incredible quote, forever in the poker history books, that one. Yep. What an incredible run. Just an incredible win here. I'll pause it right here. Ryan, thank you so much for doing this with me. It's been a tremendous amount of fun to relive all these moments. And, you know, now you just got to work really hard to give me a reason to have you on the show again.
Yes. Yeah, I need to win some more stuff. Once quarantine's done, I'm ready.
I love it. I love it. All right, Ryan, thank you so much. For you guys at home, thanks so much for watching. I'll say it once more. Please like this video, subscribe to the channel, and tell all your friends. Plenty of top level winners on this show. We have Martin Jacobson, we have Greg Merson, Scott Blum's team was on recently as well, and of course those main event winners from the past. For Ryan Reese, my name is Remco Rinkema, and this was Run It Back.